Come see the new quiz show, Go Fact Yourself, with special guests Andy Richter and Fresh Air's Tanya Mosley. It's March 23rd at the Crawford. Get your tickets at laist.com/events.
LAist Studios.
Hey there, Brian here. We have something new for you today. We're dropping an episode of the latest Imperfect Paradise series, Strippers Union. It features our North Hollywood strip club, its dancers, and their fight to unionize. It's one of the hottest stories of last year's hot labor summer. Alrighty then, let's take a listen.
Hey, you're listening to Imperfect Paradise from LAist Studios. I'm your host, Antonia Cerejido. This is part two of our four-part series, Imperfect Paradise Strippers Union, the behind-the-scenes story of the first U.S. strip club to unionize in decades. Previously, we met the dancers at Star Garden Topless Dive Bar and learned about the safety issues and sense of community that led the dancers to mobilize.
We just had a lot of love for each other. And we solidified that the only way we're going to be able to do something is if we organize together.
This episode, what happens when the Star Garden dancers go public with their campaign and receive some pushback?
I think that it's really easy for white folks to have like some fragility when you first come to them with issues like that.
And what happens as their campaign persists?
I feel like an American. Like, I don't know. It's like finally able to vote for something because I can't vote for anything. So it was really exciting.
After an hour of a closed meeting, these dancers and their supporters watched on a Zoom call as the vote was stopped. The employer is challenging 16 of the 18 ballots received.
LAist producer Emma Alabaster takes the story from here.
Spring and summer of 2022 was a time of picketing for the Star Garden strippers. They told us they were outside the club every night for a couple of weeks and then moved to weekly pickets. And each one had a theme. Former LAist producer Phoenix So dropped by that summer.
So tonight is the French Revolution theme. I happen to have this Marie Antoinette costume, and I wear it whenever I have an excuse.
This is Reagan, one of the more veteran strippers we met last episode.
I think that there's like a really fun correlation between like the analogy of the French Revolution and Marie Antoinette, because our bosses won't give us basic safety that we're asking for, but they will like throw us a birthday party. They like threw me a birthday party in January, a month before I was fired. Like, oh, the peasants, they want safety? Oh, let them eat cake.
Other picket themes included Braveheart, clowns, babe tricks, meaning the Matrix, but with babes. They even had a picket where everyone dressed up like different violations they had cited in their OSHA complaint, like the broken pole.
Strippers united will never be divided! Strippers!
The dancers told me that picketing week after week for 8 months straight was exhausting, physically and emotionally.
United will never be divided!
They said things felt tense with the club security guards who were outside the door and with customers they were trying to turn away from the club.
Shame, 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 shame.
But the fun picket themes helped sustain the dancers for a long fight, and it was also part of their communication strategy. The dancers would post videos on their Instagram account, Stripper Strike NoHo, NoHo for North Hollywood. Eventually, it would grow to over 13,000 followers. Chris Smalls from the Amazon Labor Union even joined a picket and posted about it online. The media noticed.
Instead of hitting the stage, they're hitting the picket lines behind me here at Star Garden Topless Dive Bar in North Hollywood.
As they locked them out, so they decided to organize.
Picketing over what they call an environment of harassment and lack of basic worker safety and cleanliness.
This episode, a whole year of the Star Garden strippers fight for a union. A year that launched their campaign into the spotlight and sparked a much larger debate among strippers about race, oppression, and the future of the strip club as a workplace.
Do you remember, like, what you thought when you first heard that that was happening at Star Garden?
I thought that it was a distraction from the real problem. I think that it's all about white tears. It's just something that's literally leaving out the most marginalized, and the people that are suffering the most are completely being ignored.
What do strippers want from their workplace? And how can they get there? And who should be leading the charge? This is Imperfect Paradise, Strippers Union, Part 2. I'm Emma Alabaster.
Social media has been both a blessing and a curse, as it tends to be.
This is Wicked, the stripper who first danced alone at Star Garden,
where we were able to reach a wide, worldwide audience and gain worldwide support. But at the same time, it does open us up to times we messed up.
On the picket line, Wicked found out pretty quickly that she was marching into complicated territory, that there were other strippers who had been organizing long before her. In the comments on Stripper Strike NoHo's Instagram posts, there were a lot of people cheering on their campaign. But they also consistently got questions and critiques from other strippers.
I could completely understand why they're fucking pissed off at this group, because it seemed so easy for us. Even though it was back-breaking effort, blood, sweat, and tears, we still got it easier. We still got attention. We got donations. We got global support.
I'm here interviewing you right now.
I know. And I'm here now. And like, even when I was coming in here, I was like, Wicked, you need to make sure that you impress upon people, like, we were not the first. We are not going to be the last.
As yet another reporter following this story, I wanted to make sure that I understood the terrain that I was stepping into. I wanted to know how this group of strippers was able to run a successful unionization campaign, but also why their campaign got pushback. The criticism that was easiest to understand: the Star Garden strippers are a mostly white group. We know the primary reason for that: the hiring practices of the club where they worked. According to all the Star Garden dancers we spoke to, management didn't hire any Black dancers since they opened the club post-lockdown. Only white dancers and some lighter-skinned dancers of color. As you might remember from last episode, we did reach out to Steve and Jenny Kazarian of Star Garden for an interview. They declined, but we talked to Star Garden management's attorney, who said she could not comment about anything that happened at Star Garden in 2021, but that she objected to characterizations of discrimination at the club. And it wasn't just that the Star Garden strippers were mostly white. They were also mostly skinny, cisgender, college-educated, U.S. citizens without visible disabilities. Some other strippers felt that Star Garden's dancers were positioning themselves as leaders, speaking for all strippers. And that sense that they were overstepping, it started with the name they chose for themselves, that Instagram handle, The Stripper Strike North Hollywood. Do you remember when you first heard about NoHo Stripper Strike?
Yeah, I got a Google alert for Stripper Strike, and it wasn't anybody that I knew. And it wasn't Black folks.
This is Kat Hollis.
I am a community organizer. I use they, them pronouns, and I am a new parent. And I have been a sex worker for a good minute.
Kat was one of the people who called out the Star Garden strippers online.
I had a lot of questions for them about whether or not they had considered that the term was largely used by the Black community and specifically like gender expansive people of color.
I called up Kat because I was curious about the history of the term stripper strike and also about Kat's own work as a Black dancer and organizer in Oregon.
One of the things I heard in Portland that I had heard before was, well, this is a rock and roll club. You're not really the look we're looking for. I was told I didn't look like I belonged on a Harley. And I was like, I don't know what that means. but obviously now I've learned what that means.
Just like at Star Garden, Kat's organizing started, in part, in a group chat. But this group chat was all Black sex workers in Portland. This was the summer of 2020. and Kat was especially angry about their experiences of racism in strip clubs.
There is solidarity and sorrow because we're all facing the same, oh, the position has been filled. We're always facing the same, like, sorry, I only get dances from white girls. Like, we're all facing the same issue, but it feels so isolating and so alone that you think it's a you problem.
Kat had heard of a movement in 2017 called NYC Stripper Strike. It was a campaign to fight racism, colorism, and unfair labor practices in New York's strip clubs. So Kat says they reached out to one of NYC Stripper Strike's founders, Giselle Marie. They wanted to make sure Giselle would give her blessing to use the term stripper strike in Portland, which Kat says she did.
I called for people to start posting on hashtag PDX Stripper Strike and to sort of blow up this hashtag with stories and to say that we weren't going back to work until certain demands were met.
The Star Garden dancers led a picket targeting one club, more of a strike in the traditional labor organizing sense. But the NYC and PDX stripper strikes were citywide campaigns to put pressure on multiple clubs and target issues across the industry, but not necessarily to call for unionization. For them, strike had a broader meaning.
More a strike like a blow than a strike like a work stoppage. Our mantra was strike while the iron is hot, right? And so it's more like a reckoning, you know, to really ask ourselves, what are we ready to hit back with? What power do we hold?
The latest group to stand in solidarity with protesters demanding racial justice is growing by the day and calls their movement PDX Stripper Strike.
For PDX Stripper Strike, Kat and their comrades made a list of demands related to racial equity. And nearly 30 Portland strip clubs agreed to attend anti-racism trainings and listening sessions and to hire more dancers of color. And since then, the Stripper Strike movement has grown to Philadelphia and Chicago. The PDX Stripper Strike eventually expanded into an organization by and for sex workers called Haymarket Pole Collective. This movement history was on Kat's mind when they came to comment on the Star Garden strippers' social media.
I think that it's really easy for white folks to have like some fragility when you first come to them with issues like that. I think that they had a mixed response that became a little bit more solidaritous as time went on.
After months of social media callouts, in August 2022, the Star Garden strippers made a post on their Stripper Strike NoHo Instagram, acknowledging the other stripper strikes. I asked one of the Star Garden strippers, Velveeta, to read the post.
The caption says, "Thank you to everyone who has voiced their concerns to us and has held us accountable. We hear and appreciate you, and we're currently discussing next steps to right our wrongs and move forward as a campaign we hope everyone can be proud of."
They also shared an infographic, Black-led stripper organizations you should know about, which included many of the stripper strikes, like Kat's. The part that stands out to me the most in that first post is this.
"We apologize for the way our name Stripper Strike NoHo has encroached on the original meaning of Stripper Strike as an anti-racism movement. While our Star Garden strike and unionization effort seek to address the rampant racism against Black women this club has perpetrated, this was not the overarching issue that mobilized us."
The Star Garden dancers I spoke to said they built a really special and supportive community. But they knew they built it at a club that didn't hire any Black dancers. And it wasn't until things felt really dire for themselves that they began to organize. I don't say this to pile on to the call-outs. What I found in my reporting and personal experience in movements and workplaces is this is usually how organizing works. People organize for their own working conditions, and while they may be mad about how their friends have been treated, it doesn't necessarily move them to act. And even in industries where there's a concerted effort to diversify the workforce, Black people in particular often end up being underrepresented, this comes up in Hollywood, tech, media, podcasting. The Star Garden stripper's apology post ends like this.
This movement is not whole without the input of Black voices, and we sincerely apologize for not doing more to include and amplify those voices from the beginning of this campaign.
When I talked to Velveeta in 2023, a year after this post went up, she told me she no longer felt it was an adequate apology and that they shouldn't have used the stripper strike name to begin with. She said that when they wrote that post in 2022, the group had considered changing their name, Stripper Strike NoHo, but decided against it. They were too worried about losing momentum and support.
In making that decision, we did prioritize our white following, like over the concerns of the dancers of color. I'm not proud of how that played out.
Despite their critiques, Kat saw parallels between the issues at Star Garden and at strip clubs across the country. So they were also invested in how things would play out for these strippers in LA.
Even being white-led, skinny-led, you know, led by people who have the ability to not work for X amount of, you know, weeks, led by people who are educated and articulate and, you know, have lawyers. And there's still so many hurdles. And I think that that struggle is so important for people to see, because I think that it's very isolating. You know, we have solidarity and we have the ability to work together for something better.
That spring and summer of 2022, while the Star Garden strippers were navigating callouts and holding it down on the picket line, they were also trying to find a union that would represent them. Because to unionize your workplace, it's a lot easier to fold into an existing union that already has resources and infrastructure. But for a while, no union would step up to represent these dancers. Their pro bono lawyer told me she thought that between the stigma of sex work and the challenges of organizing in an industry that isn't unionized at all, most unions weren't up for the risk. But then...
Hey, I'm Kate Schindel. I'm president of Actors Equity, and I am so stoked to be working with everyone from Star Garden.
This was a game changer. Actors Equity is a huge established union. It represents live theater performers and stage managers, over 50,000 of them. The Star Garden strippers would now have the support of this union staff, including attorneys and PR teams. This was their announcement on social media.
As an equity worker who has long since supported this industry and even portrayed members of their industry on professional stages, it only makes sense that these fierce live performers are getting the same protections that we are.
I'm really excited that these workers...
After almost 8 months of picketing, the dancers made history by getting union representation. They held a graduation-themed picket to celebrate.
Congratulations, class of 2022. You're gonna win!
Yeah!
You've already won.
The dancers all wore graduation caps and gowns with their stripper looks as reveals underneath. They made graduation speeches on the sidewalk outside Star Garden. And Tom Morello from Rage Against the Machine played union songns on the picket line to celebrate.
Virginia, the teacher in Chicago, janitor in Mississippi, from the dancers of North Hollywood.
Yeah!
There's a thundercloud exploding, and I'm free at last.
Yeah!
Like the union men and women standing up and standing strong.
Woo!
Your numbers.
But they weren't officially union strippers yet. The dancers would need to vote on whether they wanted to join Actors Equity. If they got the votes, then Star Garden would become a union club. At that time, the only unionized club in the country.
In the fall of 2022, that's when you cast your ballots for the union vote, right?
Yes. Selena is one of the strippers that Star Garden had fired. You heard from her last episode.
I remember checking my mailbox every single day and like just being so excited and then just getting hit with bills. And I'm like, oh, this is not, I'm not looking for the bills right now. Like I want the ballot.
Selena says, since she's undocumented, this moment held extra significance.
I feel like an American. Like, I don't know. It's like finally able to vote for something because I can't vote for anything. So it was really exciting.
In November 2022, it was finally time for the election. The Star Garden strippers posted a video on Insta set to "I Endorse These Strippers" by Nicki Minaj. I endorse these strippers. I endorse these strippers. I am Nicki Minaj and I support these strippers. This song came out a decade earlier, so definitely wasn't about these particular strippers, but Nicki's saucy, sexy shout out to strippers in general, as if Nicki is a political candidate whose platform is having a good time at the strip club, well, I get why these dancers chose it. In the IG video, the song plays over a montage of each dancer with a sealed envelope. A lot of them are in their pleasers and fishnets as they strut to their local mailboxes and drop off their ballots. The dancers were sure that they all voted yes. It seemed imminent that they would get their union. Everything finally seemed to be coming together. But then, it all came crashing down.
But after an hour of a closed meeting, these dancers and their supporters watched on a Zoom call as the vote was stopped. The employer is challenging 16 of the 18 ballots received.
Star Garden claimed the dancers weren't really employees and therefore could not form a union. That's coming up after the break on Imperfect Paradise. We'll be right back.
Selling a little or a lot? Shopify helps you do your thing, however you cha-ching. Shopify is the global commerce platform that helps you sell at every stage of your business. From the launch your online shop stage to the first real-life store stage, all the way to the did we just hit a million orders stage, Shopify's there to help you grow. Whether you're selling scented soap or offering outdoor outfits, Shopify helps you sell everywhere. From their all-in-one e-commerce platform to their in-person POS system, wherever and whatever you're selling, Shopify's got you covered. Shopify helps you turn browsers into buyers with the internet's best converting checkout. 15% better on average compared to other leading commerce platforms. And sell more with less effort thanks to Shopify Magic, your AI-powered all-star. Shopify powers 10% of all e-commerce in the U.S. And Shopify is the global force behind Allbirds, Rothy's, Brooklinen, and millions of other entrepreneurs of every size across 175 countries. Plus, Shopify's award-winning help is there to support your success every step of the way. Because businesses that grow, grow with Shopify. Sign up for a $1 per month trial period at shopify.com/paradise, all lowercase. Go to shopify.com/paradise now to grow your business, no matter what stage you're in. Shopify.com/paradise.
Hey, what's up, y'all? I'm Pendarvis Harshaw, host of the Right Now-ish podcast. Every week, I talk to the people who are creating art and culture and spreading it to the universe.
As an artist, you always meet yourself. Every year, you're a different person.
Essentially, we normalize a space where you can show up as your authentic self.
Check out Right Now-ish, rooted in California's Bay Area, speaking to you.
It's so many people of color, so many queer people. It's like I'm being celebrated in my fullness.
Available wherever you listen to podcasts.
This is Imperfect Paradise. I'm LAist producer Emma Alabaster. As you might recall, we repeatedly asked Star Garden management for an interview. And one of the things we were curious about was why they opposed unionization. They declined to talk with us, but their attorney said in an email that, quote, most employers would rather deal directly with their employees than through an intermediary who charges those employees dues, unquote. The National Labor Relations Board cites an estimate that overhead costs for a unionized organization are 25 to 35% higher than a non-union one. According to the U.S. Bureau of Labor Statistics, in 2023, a private industry employer spent a little over $15 per hour more on compensating a union employee than a non-union employee. And on top of that, managing a unionized staff might mean hiring human resources, lawyers, and dealing with government agencies. So Star Garden management was challenging the union votes. Here's what that's all about. When the strippers were hired at Star Garden, many of them signed paperwork agreeing to be independent contractors, not employees. And independent contractors, they can't really unionize in the same way employees can, with the power to bargain with management. So Star Garden's lawyers were saying, hey, these dancers are independent contractors. They can't form a union. But to legally be an independent contractor, you have to meet certain criteria, like having control over your schedule. So it might not matter what papers the dancers signed if they were being treated as employees.
As for what happens now, the National Labor Relations Board will schedule a hearing to decide whether to accept those challenge ballots.
Whether they were or weren't employees, the National Labor Relations Board would decide in a hearing set for about 6 months out. For the dancers, that would mean 6 more months of not making any money at Star Garden. 6 more months of anxiety and waiting and trying to keep momentum on their campaign. But this question of whether strippers should be independent contractors or employees, it doesn't just have stakes for Star Garden or strip club owners. It's actually a huge topic of debate among strippers themselves, especially in California.
Our next panelist is Onyx Black. Onyx?
I am very grateful to be here. My name is Onyx Black.
Onyx Black is one of the most vocal strippers organizing against employee status in California.
So I just want to also put that there has been no real research on how strippers feel about this. We don't want to be employees. Us marginalized want to be independent contractors having a choice. Even the person
here, Onyx is speaking at a California Commission on Civil Rights hearing. And there's this moment where she specifically mentions the Star Garden strippers.
Even the media, they are blowing up 15 strippers in a tiny little place in Southern California, not understanding that the huge picture of all strippers here in California are suffering. We don't
want to. While the Star Garden strippers were fighting to be union employees, Onyx was doing everything she could to let lawmakers, other strippers, and the internet know that she didn't agree. According to Onyx, most strippers don't want to be employees. She believes it's better to be a contractor because you have flexible scheduling, cash in hand at the end of the night, better pay, and less surveillance by your club. I wanted to talk to Onyx to understand why she kept pushing back against this unionization campaign and what she was hoping for instead.
My name is Onyx Black. I'm a Virgo. My pronouns are she, her, and hers. I am a dancer, exotic dancer, stripper, other SW as well, and I teach like exotic dance and pole.
To understand Onyx's perspective on employment status, we need a little backstory. Onyx is Black and born and raised in California. She started stripping around the age of 37. So she had several careers before this one, including in customer service, education, the nonprofit world.
I do have my degree in biology. I came from corporate. It's one of the most toxic places I've ever worked. You know, having like, you know, all of these white men looking down on you and you're in a science lab and how dare you know anything. And at the strip club, all of those white men are giving me money and I'm looking down at them.
Onyx's move into stripping was great at first. When she was an independent contractor.
I could make my own schedule, come in when I want, talk to whoever I want, give dances to whatever I want, wear what I want, do what I want, when I want it, how I want it, make money how I want it, and good-ass money. I helped to pay my mama's mortgage. I got to go on vacation, take my cats to the vet. I got to just have more of a viable life. I didn't know how good I had it until it changed.
The reason it changed? Strip clubs got caught up in a debate about gig work. For several decades now, we've seen a rise in the gig economy. Trucking, rideshare companies, home health care, hospitals, all hiring workers as contractors. And that's brought attempts at regulation.
Known as the Gig Workers Bill, AB 5 makes independent contractors like rideshare drivers into company employees.
The Gig Workers Bill, or AB 5, was a California law that went into effect in 2020. And it was meant to create tighter standards for who is considered an independent contractor. One of those standards is that a contractor should be doing work that's outside the usual course of business. So, for example, You can make the case that a plumber at a strip club is an independent contractor, but a stripper at a strip club? One study looked at 75 federal and state court cases about misclassification filed by strippers over the last 3 decades. It found that they won 93% of the time, meaning strippers throughout the country have a really strong case for being treated as employees, regardless of what their clubs say. When AB 5 passed, it seemed like California might crack down on worker misclassification.
It outlines strict guidelines for corporations like Uber and Lyft so drivers get minimum wage, overtime, and paid time off.
In theory, here's how it's supposed to work. California strip clubs should have reclassified their dancers as employees, with all the benefits that come along with that. But there's no enforcement of this law. No way to make sure club owners are doing things by the book, unless a stripper decides to sue. So what really happened was a different story. My team spoke with a bunch of other dancers, researchers, and journalists about what went down. Here's what we learned. When these new stricter rules about contractor status became law, clubs generally responded in 2 ways. One, some clubs like Star Garden continued to classify their dancers as contractors. And 2, the clubs that did make the switch to employee status, what we heard is the way they did that caused a lot of grief among California strippers, like Onyx.
2019, I heard that something was developing and my club was going to be changed to employee status and that they can only keep a selective few. Everybody was trying to scramble and look for work. It was just a really scary time. And sure enough, the club that I was working at, they all removed 50% of their dancers and I was one of them.
This is how some clubs responded to AB 5. They made some of their dancers employees and then fired a lot of the others. And who was fired? The clubs seemed to cut the dancers that they thought were least profitable. Who do you think was most impacted by AB 5?
Well, it was all of us marginalized. So all my transgender sisters, undocumented. If you have a felony, sucks to be you. My, I have a disabled friend that's an amputee, that's a dancer. She don't work in the clubs anymore either. There were more larger body dancers in the clubs back in the day. Now that they're employees, they don't hire nobody as dark as me or old as me. So if you are not young, white, and skinny, or white passing, that's who's mostly in the clubs.
Onyx said that she did find some work after AB 5, but the conditions were worse. So she took a break from stripping for a while.
A lot of the dancers at that club, a lot of them not even dancing anymore. They just retired. A lot of dancers moved.
Onyx and other dancers we spoke to said that because it was harder to find work stripping, some dancers transitioned to forms of sex work that are more criminalized. And the dancers who were able to stay in the clubs after AB 5? Those we talked to said they didn't get the benefits that are supposed to come from employee status, like healthcare or paid time off. Businesses are only required to give those benefits after workers put in more than 30 to 40 hours a week. And stripping is mostly too physically demanding for that. I've heard of strippers who work anywhere from a few hours a month to 25 hours a week. So strippers weren't getting employee benefits. And on top of that, they were making less money and had less scheduling flexibility. So, in summary, tighter rules about employee status were supposed to make things better for workers in California. But according to many of the strippers we talked to, the way clubs reacted actually made things worse. Which is why some dancers like Onyx want a carve-out from AB 5. That's actually something rideshare companies got, so their drivers could be contractors. And that's what Onyx wants too. To go back to being a contractor.
The employee status thing ain't working. We need to get the most people in the club to work. It goes back to harm reductive solutions.
Harm reduction, as in things at the strip clubs weren't perfect before AB 5, but at least more dancers were able to keep their jobs and make better money than they're making now. But for the Star Garden dancers and other strippers who want to be employees, the answer is to use employee status, to unionize. They believe that once they become union employees, they can bargain for a contract with greater protections. for themselves and future dancers at their club. A contract that could address the concerns of dancers like Onyx. A contract that gives dancers a better cut of the money and flexibility in scheduling and more diverse hiring. Here's Velveeta.
Through unionization in our contract, we can put in measures where the rehiring of dancers includes like diversity initiatives.
What about the critique that in order to get the benefits of employment status, you need to work 30 plus hours and like most strippers can or don't want to do that?
When you're bargaining your contract, you're starting from like a blank slate. So for instance, we want health coverage. It's our job in our contract to bargain with the employer so that they agree to pay into the health insurance. They might want to say, we're only going to pay for health insurance for employees that work a certain minimum number of hours a week. And then we have power in the bargaining process to dictate what that's going to be.
And it could be less hours than 30.
Yeah, exactly. So if they want to go with the government mandated minimum, then you can withhold your labor, you can strike, you can do these things to force them to give you what you want.
The way I see it, Onyx is fighting for a return to an imperfect but known past. And the Star Garden strippers are fighting for an idealistic but unknown future. Because we just don't know yet if they'll be able to bargain for the things they want in their contract. Whether this could be replicated in other clubs, or if other strippers would even want to work under that model. In the months after the stalled union vote, the dancers stopped picketing and focused on preparing to testify at the National Labor Relations Board hearing, getting ready to prove that they were employees of Star Garden. And then, in December 2022, Star Garden management made a move that I didn't expect. A move that made me wonder if they were trying to evade the union and even the NLRB hearing completely. A move that I was sure would have repercussions for the dancers. Star Garden management declared bankruptcy. They wanted to close down the club. That's after the break on Imperfect Paradise.
Imagine if you could charge your electric vehicle at the places you already love to eat, shop, and play. Whether you're at the movies, on your weekly grocery trip, or running errands at your local mall, Volta EV charging stations are built around your day-to-day and located in your community and nationwide. All you have to do is check in, plug in, and go about your day. It's EV charging made convenient. Download the Volta app to find your new favorite place to charge.
This is LAist producer Emma Alabaster. You're listening to Imperfect Paradise.
Our club!
If we don't get it!
Shut it down!
Oops, I already did that.
It's March 18th, 2023 at 11 p.m. Tonight, the Star Garden Topless Dive Bar in North Hollywood is closed, and the party is happening outside.
Gather up your jackets.
A vendor is rolling up taquitos, there's a karaoke dance circle, and folks on the sidewalk carry protest signs. Stripper safety over boss's profit, twerk union, and honk if you heart boobs. It's a full circle moment because it's been a whole year since the Star Garden dancers went on strike. Senior producer Natalie Chudnovsky is at the scene, getting reactions from the dancers.
We had our last shift in Star Garden 1 year ago yesterday.
We are doing a reunion picket. It's the 1 year anniversary since we walked off the job and delivered our safety petition to the bosses.
This is Charlie and Lilith, two of Star Garden's strippers.
Before we stopped picketing, the point of the picket was to turn away customers going into Star Garden. But now, Star Garden is closed down, so we don't have to do any screaming tonight. We will. We don't have to do any screaming tonight.
It's been over 3 months since Star Garden filed for bankruptcy and closed down. There's no one inside tonight.
it's very bittersweet because, you know, this whole time we've just wanted to return to work. So it is sad for us to see the corpse of the club we once loved. But also it's a huge win. We've said since the beginning, if we don't get it, shut it down.
The last few months have been a waiting game. The dancers are preparing for the NLRB hearing, waiting to see how this bankruptcy situation plays out. They've started a strike fund to support themselves while they're out of work. And they've been doing pop-up co-op shows. What makes it a co-op show is that it's organized by the dancers themselves, including dancers from other clubs, and they split the money equally. It's something that started in the beginning of the pandemic, and now it's helping the dancers support themselves while they're on strike. And the co-op shows have also given them a taste of what it's like to have strippers in charge. And they're hungry for more. Here's senior producer Natalie talking to Wicked.
Talk to me about this bankruptcy situation.
From what I understand, they are under fire. They have overextended themselves. And it does open up an opportunity, hopefully, for us to supersede and take our place in the business.
What Wicked is talking about is buying the club. Because the bankruptcy might present an opportunity. The dancers think there's a chance that Star Garden's management will liquidate and be forced to sell the club, and that the dancers could buy it.
So if you're manifesting like a year in the future, what is the dream?
This is such a good question. We love this. A year from today, we will be very busy with our own club and sharing the wealth. We'll be unionized and functioning as a co-op, worker-owned, worker-run.
This is their ultimate dream. Not just a unionized club, but a club owned and run by the dancers themselves. They think a worker-owned cooperative club would allow them to reconcile strippers' different desires and needs, to truly address workplace issues of security, scheduling flexibility, and diversity.
A year ago, it was just all white girls and then me, you know?
This is Selena.
Oh, absolutely.
So it's like to see it in a year from now to be like black, trans, Latinas, a lot more Latinas, Asians to be in there. I feel like that would be like a good dream come true for me.
The dancers want to be their own bosses, do their own hiring, and set their own rules. And they might get to do it at the very club that brought them together.
Describe the scene as you're like coming up and you're working here.
It's a dream. Okay, we do this every day. All we do is talk about this scene. I imagine it like a big whiteboard and everyone has like their duties of the night, whether it's like setup, cleanup, whatever. I just see everyone already stepping into the roles that we have been stepping into. And I imagine like Wicked whipping everyone into shape. Like, come on guys, we open in 20.
I would love to walk in and be in a place that you know walking in that you're going to be respected, that you're going to be paid for the work that you do. Because I know, like, across the country, I've been reached out to, like, dancers are holding their breath. Strippers are waiting to see if we can win this, if we can take it home. Because if we can, we will prove it can be done. That this very privileged group, like, if we can just be the wedge in the door, I know that others will take advantage.
LAist producer Emma Alabaster reporting the story. Next time on Imperfect Paradise Strippers Union, management finally comes to the table.
We all didn't believe it at first. We were very wary of the switch up. Then when it was like, no, they're serious. After 15 months, they're ready to talk.
And Emma grapples with the limits of unionization.
What I hear in that is that there are like larger, more radical shifts that would greatly help sex workers, right?
That's coming up on Imperfect Paradise. Listen to new episodes of the podcast every Wednesday or tune in on Sunday nights at 7 p.m. on LAist 89.3 or LAist.com. This episode of Imperfect Paradise Strippers Union was written and reported by Emma Alabaster, with co-writing and co-reporting by Natalie Chudnovsky. I'm the show's host, Antonia Cerejido. Catherine Mailhouse is the executive producer of the show, and Shayna Naomi Crockmull is our vice president of podcasts. Natalie Chudnovsky is the senior producer. The editor is Audrey Quinn. Production help by James Chow and Marina Peña. Sound design by James Chow and Emma Alabaster. Jens Campbell is our production coordinator. Research help from Ali Bianco, Rebecca Katz, and Marina Peña. Our sensitivity reader is Autumn Harris. Fact-checking by Caitlin Antonios. Mixing by E. Scott Kelly and Donald Paz. Special thanks to Laura Ubate, Kyria Traber, and Phoenix So. And thank you to Domino Ray, Dominique Pearson, Michael Leroy, and Susan Elizabeth Shepherd for their insights that shaped our reporting. This podcast is powered by listeners like you. Support the show by donating now at laist.com/join. This podcast is supported by Gordon and Dona Crawford, who believe quality journalism makes Los Angeles a better place to live.
Hey, it's Brian, the host of How to LA, a podcast that is a love letter to Los Angeles. Independent movie theaters are having a glow-up moment.
Vidiot and Eagle Rock, amazing. We have our friends at the American Cinematheque. The Vista just reopened.
In our new series, Revival House, we'll take you inside these spots and share their history. Because movie history is LA history. Listen to Revival House on How to LA wherever you listen to podcasts.